all my aquariums.
My favorite type of video to do, show you all my fish tanks, but I haven't done one in like 3 months, and I think it's time I give you guys an update on what we're working with, some upcoming things, some what's working, what's not working with each tank, etc. Well, let's just go. So first and foremost, as soon as you walk into the door, we're confronted with the 700 gallon. This tank's 8 feet long, 5 feet front to back, and like 2.5 feet tall or so, closer to 3 feet. In it, we got the Asian arowana, ultimate blood red, who's just tenfold, looking so much better right now. His fins are perfect, his coloration is fantastic, no missing scales, he hasn't been jumping or stressed out or anything, he's eating good, he's just an awesome fish right now. The rays, all spending more and more time grouped up, we'll see what happens over the next few months, but I'm going to start upping their feeding to try to get them to spawn. We do have the male's claspers are fully rolled, so he is mature at this point. And we have a really big female right here that is totally capable of producing some pups. And then, of course, if we look back in the background, we'll see our Beischer back there. A lot of people ask about him, and a lot of people actually forget. Now, you guys will remember that we painted the bottom of these logs with Plasti-Dip, and for the most part, they're still on there. It's non-toxic, but it can peel off. That's the benefit of using it sometimes. The rays are chewing at it and ripping it off, so over time, it's just going to come completely off. I figure it was worth a shot. See what would happen, but other than that, one of the things that you'll notice is the logs are never in the same place. The rays move them wherever they want, which is kind of cool. I try not to let them group up like this so the arowana doesn't panic or get stuck behind one or flip out in some way, shape, or form. He's waiting for food right now. He's staying perfectly still. He's hungry. He wants me to feed them. We're not doing feeding in this video, though. I got too much I got to do today, so I won't have time to do that. But we'll do that in, like, an upcoming video. Actually, I'm going to feed these guys something that they've never had before, and I think you guys are going to really like it. Anyways, as soon as we walk in here, you guys will remember that we originally had the cylinder tank used to be right here. Now there's a stack of 40-gallon tanks. I was going to put them on these metal racks, but I don't trust them at all. I'm going to build one. I think I'm going to do it 3 high. And have 3 40-gallon breeders there, and maybe we'll put 1 or 2 here, I don't know. But this, I think I'm going to turn it into a filter, or I'm going to come up with something cool, because I want to rebuild and the filtration on the 2000 as well as the 700. Nothing really wrong with them, but I think I could do something better, and it's always fun to kind of build some stuff. And I haven't built large filters for a couple of years, I think, even though we've got 10, 20, 30 videos on massive filtration and building them. I just haven't had the necessary need to build one just yet. The 2000. This is interesting. Before we jump into it, I just mentioned I'm going to be rebuilding the filtration over here, which is just a big canister filter, typically used on ponds and whatnot. But I want to do something like an overhead filter, something that's more customizable. I have some ideas, but ultimately, one of the problems right now is when I was originally putting this background on, moving some things around, adjusting filtration, when we drained it, blah, 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 I had to move the filter. I also had to move its heater. So if you guys don't remember, when I built this tank, I installed in-ground heating. So there was pipes on the bottom underneath the concrete that I could pump full of hot water, and it would heat the tank like that. However, I had to move this, but I still need to heat this tank because it is getting winter. The ground is freezing. And it's starting to impact the foundation here, like making it colder. So this tank got down to like 22 degrees one day, and I was like, okay, gotta figure out something. We did get it back up to, 26 is typically where it's at, which is perfect. How I'm doing this is really cool though. Okay, I just set this up like a couple days ago, so nothing's cute or, you know, pretty or anything. I don't care because I got so much other stuff I gotta do, and it's just gonna get moved. It's temporary. This is a on-demand heater. So you put it under your sink and you have hot water immediately. What I've been doing is I put a pump, and it's ugly, of course. I put a pump in the aquarium and I have it turned on, and it comes through and it pumps the warm water back to the tank. But if I continuously do that, two things are gonna happen. I could overheat the tank, or this is just isn't gonna be effective anymore because the water's going through it too quickly and not heating it fast enough. Although I could turn the pump down. What I decided I would do, and I'd have more control, is if I put it on a timer. So here it is here. You can see all the like little push down knobs. That's when it comes on for 30 minutes, shuts off for a few hours, turns on, shuts off. It's super effective, and it's really working well. So I might incorporate that idea into the final filtration build. I do think what I want to do, I got so many other things I got to figure out, but let me show you what's slowing me down in terms of setting all this up and building that huge tank that I told you guys about, remember? I want to build this plywood aquarium. I got to put it there. I had to move all those racking. We'll get to that in a second. But Aqua Decor started to send me all of this rock work that's going to go on the walls, but I only got like 20% of it. I got to wait for all of it so I can figure out where it's going to go and what it's going to look like, et cetera, et cetera. And then I can build the tank, and then I can build the filter, et cetera. But this tank was moved. I moved all these racking systems down, which was a sin because those tanks were really awesome, and we all had a tremendous amount of fun building them and putting them together. We didn't build them, but escaping them and whatnot. The problem is the lights on them were horrible. The plants were just dying. Nothing I could do. I wasn't going to invest any more money into those. I figured we'll just go a little bit bigger. So I figured if we set up 4 40-gallon breeders, everybody can have one. But I did have other builds in that and other scapes that I never showed. They were supposed to be on video. I was supposed to film them, edit it. I just didn't bother. I was like, those videos, to be honest, nobody was, it wasn't as popular as I thought it would be. But a lot of people enjoyed it, but for the majority of people, they just didn't watch them. As for the 2000, the pothos is growing pretty good. Let me see what else we got to update. I don't have the waterfall on right now, just for purposes of the video, so I don't have to scream. But the walrus are all doing fine. The lights just came on out here, so everybody's not going to be like jumping around looking for food or anything like that. The archer fish are always out and about, doing really well. Oh, and that heater, there's the pump there. That heater is for potable water. It's not going to hurt anybody. It's for drinking water. If we can drink it, the fish can be fine in it. There's a severum right there. We guys will remember we have six big walrus in here, 12 severums. We also have the sunshine pleco, and then we got a ton of these archer fish. Tank looks cloudy on this camera, but it's actually not. I think it has to do with like the reflection of the sand, and I don't know. This tank is going good. What about the Corydora? They don't show up during the day. They just come out at night, and they're all in crevices, like all throughout this. They get behind the background as well. There's tiny little places for them to do so. So they go back there cleaning it up. It's pretty cool. A lot of the times though, they'll also spend their time like just sitting on the rock work. So that's been pretty interesting. I'm still excited. I got to get some more fish in here because these guys are like, when they get nervous or they're not always out and about. Hopefully that will change over time once they get more comfortable in this tank. But I can't wait till we get the angel fish in here and we put a few more things together. But this tank for the most part is doing fantastic. I also slowed down the surface movement a little bit because the archer fish are starting to spit at me. I'll have to get that on camera at some point. Okay, this tank is doing fantastic. The plants are growing fast. In fact, I'm still have a little bit of hair algae in here, but not like it was. I do combat it a little bit. It is coming out slowly, but angels are doing fantastic in here. All the plants are just growing out of control. I'm having a hard time keeping up with them. That's because, of course, we're doing CO2 injection. So we got a mess of plants over here. I got to shape them and make them look proper before they start dying off because they're not getting enough light. But all the plants in here are doing fantastic. This tank, no complaints. Just a beautiful tank. I really like it. What else is new here? Nothing. Angels are fine. I think in a couple more months or even a month or something, we might take them and move them here. And maybe we'll do a different stocking idea on this one. Or maybe we'll scape it differently. Who knows? The Frontosa tank. This tank is out of control in terms of the shell dwellers and their fry. I do have like a brush algae in here, or brown algae. It's not a huge problem. It's in there. It's actually always been in there. And it's not even that bad. It's just on a little few surfaces here and there. But I leave that. Oh, and on these shells. A lot on these shells. I leave it on the shells. I leave it in the tank because it offers, nutrient export. The fry can munch on it if they want to, swim amongst it. It just becomes a little bit more natural for them. And I find that if you're going to have shell dwellers, the biggest key to success with these guys is, it's tough to see their little babies on camera, but the biggest success with these guys, and if you're going to breed them, in my opinion, is have a very well-matured aquarium. Detritus, algae, basically a messy tank, and these guys will go nuts. When this tank was like brand new almost, everything was clean, they wanted nothing to do with breeding, but as soon as it aged, they immediately just went nuts. I couldn't even count how many shell dwellers are in there. The Frontosa are getting big. They're hiding right now because I'm pointing at the, pointing the camera at them, but they probably doubled in size for sure, which is pretty cool. A saltwater tank. This is going to look a lot different to a lot of you guys. Let me adjust this lighting here. There. Looks a little more natural. So you guys know we had this massive rock with like 15 anemones on it. But I thought, you know, this looks kind of horrible. I kind of wish I had more rocks in there. I had all this scrap branch rock. So I decided I'll just pile it all up and toss the rock on it. And what will happen is when the anemones want to split or move, I think they'll find a new place on the rock. And eventually they'll cover the entire rock area and we'll just have this massive mound of anemones with a dozen clownfish swimming amongst them. Because if you can tell, we've got one anemone down here doing good, another one up there, which is actually growing really quickly. He was the size of him like a week ago, so he's like just getting huge. And I don't even feed the anemones directly. I put it on, that responsibility goes to the clownfish. Whenever I feed the clownfish, they'll go ahead and spit some to the anemones at times. But this tank is doing good. Oh, a little porcelain crab. That's all that I've changed there, is added this in and just kind of messing around, seeing what it was going to be like. But yeah, so far it looks good. And then of course, Tyrese's aquarium. You guys will remember my Fajaca Puffer Tyrese, my son named him. I'm feeling bad for him. I kind of want him in a community. I don't know if he'll survive or if he'll kill everything in the 2000, but that's been on my mind for a while about moving him. We'll see what happens though, of course, but he's putting on some size. He's getting big. He's got to be pushing 8 inches at this point, but he's not the biggest puffer in here. He's also not the smallest. You guys will remember I accidentally... I got to make a whole video on this tank because it's an absolute mess, and the story of the fish are funny. It deserves its own video. We'll come back to that, but as a spoiler alert, there's like 20 Amazon puffers in there. The biggest puffer in the building is Kevin. Kevin is huge. Some people ask, like, what's that stuff on his belly? It's not there all the time. He lays in the sand every once in a while, and the sand simply sticks to his slime coat for a short period of time. When I first came in here, he was laying on the ground, and then now that he's woken up, this will all fall off here throughout the day. But he sleeps. He snuggles down into the substrate there. As for the green star polyps, well, hit or miss with some of them. I mean, some of them are doing okay. You can see them throughout the rocks here and there. But for the most part, they're like a little graveyard because Kevin just can't leave them alone. Some of them are doing good. And, you know, it was a nice experiment. And I'm just going to leave it, see what happens. But for the most part, I just do water changes on this tank. And, you know, once a month or something, feed the fish. All the fish are getting huge, though. You know, he's got to be, I don't know, closer to 10 inches. Do you see the trigger try to nip his sand off? Yeah, this guy's going to get really big too. They're all going to get kind of big. Yeah, I love this tank though. This is the tank I sit and watch the most. It's just so funny to watch. Like, Kevin's almost like their dad. Keeps everybody in line. The two blue tanks stick together. The fox face is always like camouflaging himself, switching colors constantly. He'll go from his classic colors of yellow body with a black and white head to they'll turn to like camouflage where it's patchy. It's pretty cool. Obviously it's a sign of stress or something, or he, you know, he does it constantly though, and everybody else looks pretty good. But we got some fat bellies in this tank. These guys gotta go on a diet. I feed them way too much. That's probably why I always have to do water changes and combat algae. Now the koi swimming pond. It's gonna be tough to see in here because of the black liner and the sun reflection or whatever, but these guys, you might be able to see like little ghosts of them. They've doubled in size, at least. They're on a feeding schedule right now every 3 days. Temperatures out here have been getting below zero, so in no time I won't be able to feed them, but I just basically pulled this out of the water so you can kind of see them. This will keep the surface broken. It's not going to freeze. I'm going to leave this running year-round, but for feeding these guys every 3 days right now, and in a couple of weeks, I'm just going to stop feeding completely because they're going to go into hibernation mode and they won't need to eat. God, they're getting big. Can you see them? They're seriously getting big. You guys are on a wide angle. Look at them all. A wide angle lens, so it makes them look weird. All my tanks do. Everything's bigger in person, trust me.
Yeah, so I also wanted to do this kind of video because I got lost in, I lost track of what my videos were, what I was working on, and I had so many filmed, and I gotta go back and circle back, and I was like, I'm just gonna do an update right now, see where everybody's at, see what you guys remember and what you don't, and then kind of like bring you up the track with, like, we're still building that plywood aquarium. It's gonna be really unique, really cool. There's a big push. People want me to do a paludarium with it, or 4 feet of water on the bottom and maybe another 3 feet of dry land, but we'll see. what happens there. That's pretty exciting. I do want to finish the wall here. Got to wait for everything to show up. I want to build a new filtration for this. And I want to build a filtration for the 700 and have the filter in the quarantine room. I forget. SuperTech's in stock right now. You guys will know it from one of the past videos where I was talking about how Canada can't get any medications. This is completely all natural. It'll work on ick with several doses. It definitely works on bacterial issues. So if you're breeding fish and they lay eggs and you don't want them to rot, or if one's not fertilized, they'll infect the rest of them. Add some of this to it, it'll stop that. Or if you have any external symptoms or anything, this has been working really well. I've also been, I only have a little bit left and I had a couple bottles of this, but I've been dosing food with it. I soak food in it, and because it's high in garlic, it smells like. Doesn't have an ingredients list, so I don't know exactly what's in it, but it smells like it's high in garlic, which is great for parasites. Anyways, link is in the description to Amazon. It's now in stock, but it's very, very limited amount, so pick some up if you want any. It also supports my local fish store. This has nothing to do with me. It's not my product. I don't sell it. I just tried it out, used it, and I was like, wow, Canada needs this. So link is in the description if you want to pick up any of that. I'd love to hear your reviews. Make some videos about it. Posts. I don't know. Just I want to see what your guys' thoughts are. And if it's working for you, if you notice any difference, et cetera, et cetera. Anyways, like I said, I got a lot of work to do. Mostly I got to clean up and then start planning what I want to do. Again, just waiting on materials to show up kind of delays everything. And, you know, when's it coming? And it's a bad time of the year to be receiving or shipping anything. So anyways, I hope you guys are having a great December. I know I am. I've had a lot of fun out here in terms of, to be honest with you, I just do my water changes and just been enjoying the fish and feeding them. Been on TikTok a lot. All of a sudden, I'm a TikToker. It's kind of fun over there, too, because nobody knows who I am. I get to make all these videos all over again. It's so exciting because I'm like, I have so much to tell you. And anyways, that's it for today's video. This probably went on way too long. Hope you guys enjoyed it. Let me know what you guys think of the tanks, what we should do in the future, what some plans might be. I'm excited about them 40-gallon breeders, building that rack and some filtration, and then building that plywood tank. The new year is going to be awesome. But I have an even bigger surprise. Give me time. I'll announce it soon. See you in the next video.